right now we're in really an amazing time. We're in a time of self-reflection, and from self-reflection, we really identify how we can just be better. It can be uncomfortable, but it gives us the opportunity to really create the next version of ourselves. And the cool thing is that version is already inside of us, just waiting to come out. And sometimes we have to get uncomfortable to get there. Let me give you an example of something I observed. When I was working on my doctorate, I would substitute teach. So I was subbing one day in a district here in California, and it was a heavily Hispanic population. And I remember working as a PE sub that day. The locker rooms have the lockers for the young people, and then there's a glass and the office for the teachers. And so we were in between classes, and they were talking about, the other two teachers were talking about a vacation. One of them had just come back from vacation. But a young lady walked in and she said, my chaclas, can you help me with my chaclas? And she's holding up her shoe and she's, you know, hobbling in because she's only on one shoe and one and the other foot doesn't have a shoe on it. And she's holding up her sandals and she's saying that she needs help. The thing is, there was a dance that day. And they had already informed me that the young people were gonna have a dance after school that day. I could tell from her voice that she was really, you know, concerned, as any 15, 16 year old would be, right? I've got this dance today after school and I've broken my shoe. And she's coming to the people who are paid to cover, protect, and help her, and clearly saying that she needs help. The teacher stopped talking about her great vacation, looks at the young lady, and says to the other teacher, chocolates, as if it were some bad thing for the young lady to say. You know, I don't know a lot of Spanish. I have one saying, me estoy aprendiendo español. That means I'm learning it. But I could tell from the context, the girl needed help with her shoe. So chocolates means shoe. So I couldn't believe that here's this baby coming in, urgently asking her teacher for some help. And instead of just saying, well, what can I do? Do I have a stapler? Do I have some glue? Maybe I can get you a pass. How far away do you live? Maybe you can go home and grab your other shoes. Instead of any of that, she's just critiquing how the girl talks. We're paid because these kids come here. That's literally what paid for your vacation. That's what paid for your house. That's what's paying for your kids to go to college. That's what paid for your car. And when this person who's literally the one that is paying you comes to you for you to actually do your job, you turn her away because you don't like her language. The fact that she speaks two languages is actually pretty impressive. And she's a kid. It doesn't just happen in education, but it absolutely does happen in education. And we can think of so many other professions in which our implicit bias, in which our preconceived notions really affect the quality of care that we give to those people who trust us, who are in their most vulnerable state. Serena Williams, when she had her baby, had to literally order her own CAT scan because she knew something was wrong and her doctors wouldn't even listen to her. Can you imagine being a multimillionaire and not getting a high quality of care? Beyonce said that she even went through very difficult moments after her pregnancy and felt that her providers were not listening to her. Apparently, there's something where people think that Black people can't receive pain. I don't know if you've ever heard it. I'm laughing because it's crazy. But we're people too. Our skin's just a little darker, but that's just like, I think, I don't even know how much of an inch. It's not even a full inch of difference. You cut it open and we've all got the same stuff underneath. It doesn't mean we don't feel pain. The rates of African-American maternal mortality are ridiculous. Why? When we have paid professionals who just don't listen to the people who are there to receive care. There's an educator that I absolutely love, and her name is Jane Elliott. Jane Elliott said that if people come through this educational system of the US and they're not racist, then the system has failed. I honestly believe that's the reason why so few people would believe that Barack Obama was born here in the U.S. Because they couldn't figure out how did all of these traps we've set. You mean you don't have a record? You don't have a baby mama? You don't have all this crazy stuff in your background that we can dig up? You must not be one of the ones that we made, because we got a whole lot of traps set. This is the systemic racism that we talk about, and it's inherent in this system. A man named James Baldwin made a quote that I think is so prolific and so timely. He said that racism is so embedded in America's fabric that when you fight it, people think that you're fighting America. We have to be very careful of how we perceive this time. There are people who say, you know, well, all lives matter. Who said they don't? Who said they don't? But all people aren't being choked to death. All people aren't literally afraid to even have any encounter at all with the police that are paid to protect and serve. That's Black people. That's unfortunately people of color. You know, if we really are here for all of humanity, then all means all. And so we deal with the thing where the issue is. You know, if I were to cut my finger, I wouldn't want a doctor that says, well, you know, all body parts matter. No, I need you to fix this finger right now, buddy. I need you to focus on the issue at hand. So I think this is something that we have to deal with on every level. And we all deal with these images, and it's a spectrum. And so what we now have to do is, once we become aware, we have to intentionally, very intentionally, use our mind and use our power to change it. We can't be passive. We can't just say things will be better. When we look back at history and we look at George Wallace and we look at the people who spit on little bitty ruby bridges, who had to be accompanied by National Guards and federal agents just to go to school, had to sit in a classroom all by herself because people refused to let their child sit in a classroom with her. We look back at them and we say, what is wrong with these people? They are on the wrong side of history. Well, they just were uncomfortable. And there's a lot of us right now that are uncomfortable. A lot of people are saying the 2020 version of what they were saying in 1968. And it's really, really sad. We have to really just understand that time is up. Things have to change. Things have to be better. And each of us has to work towards it. Each of us has to do our part. No matter what your sphere of influence is, no matter what your profession is, be humane, intentionally. Use your power for good. Figure out ways that you can connect, that you can help. Maybe it's not something that you can do one-on-one. Maybe you can donate to a cause. Maybe you can help a young person to, you know, get involved in something that would help them to create a better life and help them to have more opportunities. The reality is that racism has functioned as a system in this country through so many realms: economy, the economic realm, education, entertainment, labor, law, religion, politics, sex, and war, as Neely Fuller has so eloquently stated. And so in all of those realms and all of those functions of society, there's elements that are maintained by a white hierarchy structure that needs to be dismantled. How many geniuses have we missed? How many inventions have we not seen? Because we literally have a fragment of our civilization that we do not equip to take over, to lead, to be the future, to be our future doctors, our future lawyers, our future congresspersons. They're cut off at the pass in education, because if they never see that they can be it, how could we expect that they would do better? We want to empower them to do better and to know that they can be better and be stronger and be greater. So there's some place for each of us. We're like the five fingers of the hand. Each one is different. This is the African proverb I'm going to share with you. We have a proverb that says, look at your hand. Each finger is different, right? You got the little chunky one. You got the little baby one. You got the one that say, put a ring on it. You got the one that points at everybody. You got the other one, don't put it up. The one in the middle, saying bad stuff. But when are they strong? Only when they work together. So we have to be very careful when we attempt to isolate others, or when we otherize the struggle belongs to all of us, and the win will be for all of us. I hope you've enjoyed today.